Okay. Now, I'm not saying that I would be allowed to do this now, but I tried a charrette that needed to be done in Past Christian that had built absolutely nothing. And this time I wasn't working for government so I could speak my mind. And I told them, first of all, that we're tired of victimization, that the world is tired of victimization. Do you realize that Google still has the aerial photographs of the hurricane? Do you realize that at one point they put the cleanup photographs and the government asked the ones that showed the ruin to be restored so that you could continue being the world's poster child for victimization? I mean, absolutely sick. And I told them, I said, guess what? Okay, you were victims, wonderful, you played the role wonderfully, but now the entire world is victimized. Okay, many, many more people have lost their jobs. Many more people have lost the houses than you have. Okay, there is a fundamental crisis naturally, and nobody gives a damn about you except yourself. So buckle up, suck it up, and let's get it done ourselves. Okay, and they loved it. They totally loved it. And we had a charrette that lasted 7 days in which everybody for the first time was an adult. And I believe that if you go to Past Christian that has built nothing in four years, coming 2 weeks, next year you're going to see an incredible amount built because finally they're on their own. Government provided an incredible amount of interference. Now a little bit of history. 1993 Andrew. We did it. You know, we all volunteered and went south. FEMA was not anywhere to be seen. Nowhere. I remember the National Guard, I remember the mayors, I don't remember FEMA. This looming federal presence, FEMA, all they did was pick up the trash and put it, make a big mountain, and bury it. That's all they did. There were no promises made, the federal government was in and out. People knew that they were on their own, and so they rebuilt. And they rebuilt almost immediately. And the same thing happened after Camille. Okay? There's a fellow, a professor at North Carolina State, I actually have a slide I wanted to show you, that has studied the crises ever since Pompeii, and including the most disparate things, earthquakes, San Francisco, fires, hurricanes, all over the world, across time and across culture. And there's a constant, there's an incredible diagram that shows what happens after 3 weeks, after 3 days, what happens after 5 weeks, what happens after 5 months, what happens after a year, like that. And there's specific times, certain things that happen. Rubble starts getting picked up there for 3 days. The streets are cleared after so much. Okay, everything is consistent. The London fire, 1688, Berlin, 1945, Chicago. Okay, guess how Katrina compares to it? There is no comparison, it's an absolute flat line. And the reason is that government made promises. Okay, and government made promises, and government did not deliver. Now, if government had delivered on what they said they would efficiently, it would have happened. But you know how it was. Wait till we decide. What's the elevation? Wait till we decide how to disperse the money. Don't touch that house. There's going to be a new code, and you'll never get insurance if you get it. It was just wait, wait, wait. So what government has to do is government has to either be efficient or get out of the way. There's only two modes, and they're both fine. But government has to be efficient, MacArthur, Berlin, Marshall or MacArthur, you know, just top down, and this is the money, and these are the standards, and we decide quickly. Actually, military operations are just get out of the way and let people rebuild. They always have, the way they always have for 2,000 years. It's one or the other. I feel so strongly about that. In fact, people can't rebuild in New Orleans, even if the government generously gives them $70,000, which was the replacement. Their houses could be rebuilt for $70,000, which is what the government gives them. But then the government, the nanny state, by raising the standards, has caused the house to cost $140,000. That's why New Orleans isn't being rebuilt. That's, you know, you've given them the fair amount, one hand gives them the fair amount, and then the other hand, who says, oh, we could never let you move back into a house that doesn't have outlets every 5 feet, you know, and double pane windows, and hurricane this, and strap that, and everything else. And you know why New Orleans is resisting? Because they don't want to be paying mortgages, because the entire culture of New Orleans is based on leisure. Okay? And the government wants to make them like people from Minnesota to have free jobs to pay for mortgages and they're not interested. Okay? And that's the beginning and the end of New Orleans. It's a culture that's based on leisure and they're not going to put up with free jobs to pay for the extra 70,000 overhang that the government has written. so it doesn't get rebuilt. Now, yeah, Brad Pitt can give people gifts. But if they had been allowed to, they could have rebuilt the houses. They always did. First of all, the way they built them in the first place, with no loans, cash on the barrelhead, which their daddies and granddaddies did, or they could have rebuilt it themselves, but not needing to hire an architect and needing to hire this and meet this and that requirement. It just didn't work. So one of two things, you either give people the proper amount of money efficiently, here's 140,000, follow the code, or just get out of the way and let people, you know, contract out of the nanny state. It's got to be one of two settings, because they're the only things that have ever worked. It's either MacArthur in Japan or Camille. Get in or get out. Two other things about the public process. There's an orgy of public participation, which I believe is severely misunderstood. Okay, the charrette. There's so many charrettes that charrettes are about to get a bad name. In fact, they probably have already. I'm surprised that they haven't. One of the things that gives the charrette a bad name is that there's so many people that palpably, despite a huge amount of money and time spent into them, are making what is, everybody knows is the wrong decision. Oh my God, they're, for example, all over Mississippi, they don't want any house. They're, I'm in Louisiana too, they're turning down houses that are under 1,000 square feet, which is precisely what the population needs, is houses under 1,000 square feet. But the neighbors object. Okay, the neighbors object. And on and on and on. Lots of things that are obviously the right thing to do, the neighbors object. Now, what is the problem? There's a cynicism that has arisen that democracy doesn't work. And there is a movement that is pronounced in the architecture schools, and you'll see it. There is a Robert Moses revival. I'm not kidding. It is absolutely explicit in the architecture schools. If you follow it, you'll see it. In the intelligentsia, top down, you need things done, don't consult. Because there's a feeling that democracy doesn't work. Well, democracy isn't working because what the charrettes have been, they haven't been democratic. Democracy does not require an enormous number of people to participate. They do not require 27,000 people at $8 million. What they require is a random sample. Okay? That is exactly why a polling organization can get within 3 percentage points of any decision by polling 1,700 people. What are they careful about? They're very careful to be clear about the question, unbiased, and they're very careful to get a random sample. Now, what happens when you simply call the neighbors in? Well, they're not a random sample. They're the NIMBYs. They're the immediate people, and we prize the people. We privilege the people. The closer you are to what needs to be built, the more standing you have. So you get one or two or three people saying no to something that is palpably better for the community as a whole. Now, I have seen democracy work. And in Perth, Australia, Western Australia, I've seen the most amazing things done. Like, for example, a public clubhouse built on a beach in front of the mansions of the most elegant people, the most expensive mansions. And I saw that, and I said, how did you do that? How did you do that? That could, you know, in the United States, we can't even get a path to the beach, you know, 3 feet wide. How did you do that? He says, oh, you Americans, you don't understand the public process. This is the way we do it. We understand that the neighbors are a vested interest. We understand that the developers are a vested interest. We've always understood that. The developer always stands differently. It's a vested interest. We understand that the neighbors are a vested interest. And we gather the opinion of the community as a whole by using the jury pool to get a random sample. So typically, if there's a project to be done, like where do we locate the hospital? Okay, the hospital is being negotiated in Baton Rouge. Okay, or let's say an apartment building that's going to be built somewhere. How do we get a random sample? They call in 500 people from the jury pool, which is, you know, has the standing of being random. They tell them that there will be time certain 3 meetings where the issues will be the charrette, the issue will be discussed, and then they will need to attend a public hearing, you know, at these dates, and they get 200 people to volunteer, of which they can count and 150 to show up.